من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. سورة الأنعام, the beautiful surah, the subject of it is التوحيد, the oneness of worship of Allah سبحانه وتعالى, and refuting all of the different evil practices and matters of beliefs of the disbelievers. When a person disbelief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when people associate partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when people are upon falsehood, it doesn't stay on that level. They keep on inventing evil after evil. And this is the way of shaitan. To those who are upon falsehood, those who associate partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, their intellect becomes very foolish. They're not having the proper understanding of things. Why? Because they don't have the purpose of this life being done in the straight way. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us to worship Him alone. This is the purpose of this life. This is the goal of this life. And all of the means on the face of earth that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provides for us is to establish this goal. So when people don't have the goals in the right place, then everything else becomes not in place. And this is what we learn from this beautiful surah, how to be upon the tawheed, and how to be consistent in matters of tawheed, and how that the practices and matters of worship is always referring us back to the tawheed, to la ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. This religion of Islam is perfect. Everything in it is perfect. Everything is in place because it's all from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every action we do, we have to refer it back to la ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. The only one to be worshipped is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the only one to be followed in the absolute sense is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Inshallah ta'ala, we'll discuss verses in Surah Al-An'am 133 to 137 that talks about different things, but mainly how when the disbelievers, they invent evil and how they invent one practice after the other. It's very easy to see how evil it is, to stay away from it, and also to state the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most rich. That means no one is in need of anything except ourselves, the human beings that are in need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not need His creation. The creation are in need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And warning those who stay upon falsehood, those who stay upon polytheism, that the matter is going to come to an end and everybody shall return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So people need to take lessons from their life that this is only limited, and everybody shall return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So let's first, inshallah ta'ala, go through these verses and see what we can learn from the benefits from it. We start with verse number 133 in Surah Al-An'am. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَرَبُّكَ الْغَنِيُّ ذُو الرَّحْمَةِ إِنْ يَشَأْ يُذْهِبُكُمْ وَيَسْتَخْلِفْ مِنْ بَعْدِكُمْ مَا يَشَأْ كَمَا أَنْشَأَكُمْ مِنْ ذُرِّيَّةِ قَوْمٍ آخَرِينَ, which roughly means, and your Lord is the free of need, the possessor of mercy. If He wills, He can do away with you and give succession after you to whomever He wills, just as He produced you from the descendants of another people. So this verse, first, it states the matter very strongly. After talking about matters of the disbelievers and how they disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they invent things and practices and matters of worship and so on, and there are of different levels in the day of resurrection, different levels of punishment, as the believers also are on different levels of rewards and mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this ayah starts with this powerful statement, وَرَبُّكَ الْغَنِيُّ ذُو الرَّحْمَةِ, your Lord. Your Lord, and every time we hear Rabbuk or the Rabb, as we mentioned that many times before, it gives you the meaning of the Lord, the Creator, the Sustainer, the owner of life and death, the owner of all things. So, وَرَبُّكَ الْغَنِيُّ ذُو الرَّحْمَةِ, your Lord is الْغَنِي. الْغَنِي is the most rich, the free of need. And الْغِنَى, when someone is in no need of anyone. And that's why when a person is rich, he has more dependencies over others. People, they need him, he does not need much. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, nothing is the like of him. He is الْغَنِي subhanahu wa ta'ala, one of the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that He is Al-Ghani, that means He's free of all needs because He's the creator of all things. Only one creator, and other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is the creation of Allah. So as a matter of fact, as something that is by necessity, if people believe in the creator of the heavens and the earth, the creator is Al-Ghani. This is something that is part of the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by necessity. And also the creation of Allah, they are the total opposite. They are fuqara ila Allah. They are in need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because He created them. Without Him, they are nothing. He's the one that created them. He's the one that would cause them to die. He's the one that would resurrect them. And this is something that is mentioned throughout the entire Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ أَنْتُمُ الْفُقَرَاءُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَاللَّهُ وَالْغَنِيُّ الْحَمِيدِ إِنْ يَشَأْ يُذْهِبُكُمْ وَيَأْتِ بِخَلْقٍ جَدِيدٍ. As close to the meaning of this verse, that O mankind, you are فُقَرَاء إِلَى اللَّهِ, you are in need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most rich. He is in no need of you whatsoever. He is the most praiseworthy subhanahu wa ta'ala. If He wills, He can get you away. He can destroy all of you, and He would bring new creation. He's the creator of all things. So the same thing the verse here is saying, وَرَبُّكَ الْغَنِيُّ ذُو الرَّحْمَةِ, that your Lord is the most rich, the one that is free of need, and He is the one that has the mercy. Both together gives a beautiful meaning. Because when people are free of any need, sometimes they act in a transgressing way. They would act in injustice. They don't care about others because they don't need them. Many people, they act kindly and they show mercy towards others because they need others. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, nothing is the like of Him. He is the most rich and He is the most merciful subhanahu wa ta'ala. He created His creation to have mercy upon them. He is the most just subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is a beautiful meaning for people to subject themselves to the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And at the same time for them, when they're worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, don't think that you're going to do any favor to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You're doing favor to your own self when you're obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, you're worshipping Al-Ghani subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one that is in no need of your ibadah, your worship, in no need of you whatsoever. You are the one in need. But He's the most merciful. He wants you to worship Him for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, to bestow His mercy upon you. Then the verse says, إِنْ يَشَأْ يُذْهِبُكُمْ وَيَأْتِ وَيَسْتَخْلِفُ إِنْ يَشَأْ يُذْهِبُكُمْ وَيَسْتَخْلِفْ مِنْ بَعْدِكُمْ مَا يَشَأْ كَمَا أَنْشَأَكُمْ مِنْ ذُرِّيَّةِ قَوْمٍ آخَرِينَ. إِنْ يَشَأْ, if He wills, يُذْهِبُكُمْ. يُذْهِبُكُمْ, that means He would do away with you. That means يُذْهِب, from ذَهَبَ, when something goes away. If He wills, He would make you go away. Means that He would make you all die. He will destroy you, all of you. If He wills, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because He's the one that created you from nothing. He's able to do all things. وَيَسْتَخْلِفُ مِنْ بَعْدِكُمْ مَا يَشَاءُ. Then يَسْتَخْلِفُ, that means He gives succession to whoever He wills after you. كَمَا أَنْشَأَكُمْ مِنْ ذُرِّيَّةِ قَوْمٍ آخَرِينَ. The same way that He produced you from descendants of another people. When we look at our lives now, in the year that we live in, and then compare this to 100 years ago, or 200 years ago, those who are present on the face of earth today, they're not the same as those who were present 200 years ago. They are totally different people. How that happens? We know how this happens. But see the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that generation follows another generation in such an ease that nobody really feel. It's not like all of them, they get destroyed and they're perished, and then another people, they become in their place. But the fact of how people are born and people die in such a way that it's amazing. It's part of the miracles of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the face of earth. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if He will, He can exchange you, make others come after you. And if you're not the ones that would worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that is able to guide whoever He wills, for them to be guided, to be steadfast on the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The benefit of these verses is basically to keep the human beings in check of themselves, that they're not all that. Human beings, they have the tendency to have arrogance. They see that they can do things and they can advance so much. But at the end, who are they? Who are we as human beings? We're nothing but a creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And since you are a creation, you're not creator, you are a creation of Allah, that means you are by default deficient and in need of the creator. When we say we are deficient, we're not belittling the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala actually will be in the opposite, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator of all things. We need to humble ourselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that's the essence of the ubudiyyah, the essence of being a slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to have this in your heart, that you are in need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You are in need of the creator to guide you, to sustain your life, to even be able to breathe one breath. We are in need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That would what? Affect our lives by making ourselves humble, by making ourselves obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one that is able to do all things. And if you think that you can live without being guided, who's the one that sustains your life? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if He will, He can exchange you with those who would come after you. And then after that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala still with the warning to those who would insist after the truth has been made clear to them, they would insist to be upon the falsehood. The next verse, 134, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّمَا تُوْعَدُونَ لَآتْ وَمَا أَنْتُمْ بِمُعْجِزِينَ, which means, indeed, what you are promised is coming, and you will not cause failure, meaning to Allah. إِنَّمَا تُوْعَدُونَ لَآتْ, such a powerful and a serious verse. إِنَّمَا تُوْعَدُونَ لَآتْ, that means whatever you have been promised, لَآتْ, that means definitely, by Allah, no doubt is coming. And there is the lam here, لَآتْ, that means it's by necessity. This is swearing by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is nothing more stronger than this. Who is the one that promised? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator of the heavens and the earth. And His promise is the truth. And if it's something that didn't happen yet, because the promise of Allah is as mentioned, is not as we might desire or so, is as mentioned in the Quran and in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised the disbelievers, the wrongdoers, that they will be among the people of the hellfire. If they die in the state of disbelief, they will be in the hellfire forever. This is the promise of Allah for them. The promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the believers, if they are believers and they're steadfast on matters of the belief, till the moment of death, they will be among the people of Jannah. The Jannah and the hellfire is not on the face of earth, it's in the hereafter. They're both created and they are present now. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make these two places the places of the human beings and the jinn. The disbelievers will be in the hellfire, and the sinners. And the sinners, if they die in the state of Al-Islam, either Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive them, or if they are punished, eventually they will enter Jannah. And Jannah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the paradise, He made it the place for the believers. So the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the truth. And there are promises on the face of earth for the believers, that if they are obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give them victory and will give them steadfastness. إِنَّا لَنَنْصُرُ رُسُلَنَا وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, that we give victory to our messengers and the followers of the messengers of Allah. And many of the promises of Allah are mentioned in the Quran, in this world and also in the hereafter. Continue with that, inshallah ta'ala, and what comes next after the break. So stay with us, inshallah. Alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. Welcome back, and we're still with verses number 133 to 137 from Surah Al-An'am, and we are in verse 134, where it states clearly that the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is coming, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fulfills His promise. He's the creator of the heavens and the earth. He's in no need of His creation. And He subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Almighty, and nobody can oppose whatsoever the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not need to promise and break His promise. The promise of Allah is the truth. And we get to know the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the revelation from Allah, in the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised the disbelievers that they will be among the people of the hellfire, unless they repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they become among the believers. And the believers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised them gardens underneath which rivers flow. And all of that is by the actions of the human beings. It's not because of this person versus another person, because of a race or a nationality or names or whatever there is. It's by the actions of the people. Disbelief versus belief. Actions, good deeds, righteous good deeds versus sins and spreading corruption, evil doing on the face of earth and so on. So the verse clearly states that إِنَّمَا تُوعَدُونَ لَآتْ. Indeed, what you have been promised is coming. If you want to know the promise of Allah, read the Quran from the beginning to the end. And remember that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ إِنَّ وَعْدَ اللَّهِ حَقٍّ. O mankind, know for sure that the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is haqq, is the truth. فَلَا تَغُرَّنَّكُمُ الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا وَلَا يَغُرَّنَّكُمْ بِاللَّهِ الْغَرُورِ. That don't let this worldly life that you live in deceive you. And do not let the shaitan, the devil, deceives you also. We are living, as it's mentioned before, in a big deception on the face of earth for the human beings, unless they seek and they are upon the light that is in the revelation from Allah. We can make that statement very clear. Whoever is away from the light of the Quran, whoever is away from the book of Allah, the revelation to the final messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they are living in a deceit. They are being deceived on the face of earth, and they're leading themselves to their own destruction. And the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the truth, if they don't see the matter the way it is, because the Quran makes the matter very clear to us. Whoever recites the Quran, reflect upon the Quran, they are far from being deceived by the adornment of this life. So إِنَّمَا تُوعَدُونَ لَآتْ. It's coming. Yes, a person might feel that his life is living for 30, 40, 50 years. It's not really long. And it's something that people see. Those who are 80 years old, they know that life, what happened to my life? What happened to our life? It passes so fast. And the same thing when people come in the day of resurrection, they would look back into this life and they would see it was nothing. It was like a part of a day, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran. Before we know it, we will be all gathered in the day of resurrection. So the matter is a very serious one, and it's a very quick one. As the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, he said, الْجَنَّةُ أَقْرَبُ إِلَىٰ أَحَدِكُمْ مِنْ شَرَكِ نَعْلِهِ وَالنَّارُ مِثْلُ ذَلِكِ. Which means the Jannah, paradise, is closer to one of you more than his shoes. And the same thing, the hellfire. The matter is very near, is very close. That's why the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, the companions radiallahu anhum, they lived this life in such a way that the hearts were attached to the hereafter. And the Prophet ﷺ ordered us to frequently mention and remember death. أَكْثِرُوا ذِكْرَ هَذِي مِنْ لَذَّتِ. That frequently remember, mention the destroyer of the desires, which is death, so that we're constantly remembering the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every time you make ibadah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, your salah, good deeds, fasting, staying away from sins, remember that the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the truth and it's coming. So do things for the sake of Allah, seek rewards from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, because the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is coming. وَمَا أَنْتُمْ بِمُعْجِزِينَ. And you are not mu'jizin. That means you cannot defeat Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You cannot overpower Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because He's the creator of the heavens and the earth. You cannot break the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. With human beings, maybe. If a human being, or even someone that is powerful, a king or a president or whatever, and he makes a promise to the people, it doesn't have to be fulfilled. People can overpower him. He can die. Whatever things can happen. But when the promise is from the creator of the heavens and the earth, then the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the truth. And nobody can change the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, كَتَبَ اللَّهُ لَأَغْلِبَنَّ أَنَا وَرُسُولِي. I ordained that myself, meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His messengers, will prevail, will be victorious. The promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the truth. And that's why the messengers of Allah, they were victorious. And the followers of the messengers of Allah, if they follow the messengers of Allah, they will be victorious, even if it takes a generation or more. This is the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the face of earth. The deen of Al-Islam, definitely, no doubt, by Allah will be victorious. Will have gain of the entire earth, as the Prophet ﷺ promised. This is the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whether people take in the means or not, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can change one generation to the other. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, His promise is the truth. So this is a subject. The same way that He fulfilled the promise to the mother of Musa ﷺ, when He ordered her to cast her son in the river, and He promised her that the son will come back to her, and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala even made Fir'aun himself to raise Musa alayhi salam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most powerful. The most tyrant, the most powerful among the human beings, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will use them to fulfill the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. they will be defeated from the same means that they thought it will save them, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is above all. And the real promise, the promise that should have our hearts attached to it at all times, is the hereafter. When people will return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the real victory, when the believers, the moment of death comes to them, when they are steadfast on the truth and they're away from falsehood. The real defeat is for those who are upon the falsehood. If the moment of death comes to them, and this is something very near to each and every one of us. So the criteria here is that the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is coming, وَمَا أَنْتُمْ بِمُعْجِزِينَ, and you cannot defeat, you cannot oppose the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the promise of Allah. The verses, as you see, has implications to it. It gives comfort to the heart. Your focus as a believer is to fulfill the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and don't worry about the outcome, because the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is coming. Just be patient and be obedient to Allah till you would see it, and you will see the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be the truth. Then after that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala given even more strong statements to the disbelievers. After they turned away from the truth, after the message has been explained to them, one verse after another. Verse number 135, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ يَا قَوْمِ اعْمَلُوا عَلَى مَكَانَتِكُمْ إِنِّي عَامِلٌ فَسَوْفَ تَعْلَمُونَ مَنْ تَكُونُ لَهُ عَاقِبَةُ الدَّارِ إِنَّهُ لَا يُفْلِحُ الظَّالِمُونَ. Which says, say, O my people, work according to your position, for indeed I am working, and you are going to know who will have succession in the home. Indeed, the wrongdoers will not succeed. So what this means is, قُلْ سَيْءُ مُحَمَّدٍ صَلَّى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ, giving that challenge to the disbelievers. يَا قَوْمِ اعْمَلُوا عَلَى مَكَانَتِكُمْ, O my people, work according to your position. What is their position? The position of disbelief. Work. Do all types of acts of disbelief. Do all kinds of acts of corruption and sins and falsehood. Do whatever you want, because you will see the outcome of your actions. Of course, the verse here is not saying to the Prophet ﷺ to tell the people to commit the acts of disbelief as a way to approve it, but it's the way where when someone is not listening to the truth, when someone is stubbornly away from the truth, then do whatever you want, because it's not going to make you prevail whatsoever. You're not going to escape and run away with your evil doing. Matters will come back to the justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everybody shall return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So whatever you do, you will see the outcome of it. So such a powerful and a severe warning for them. قُلْ يَا قَوْمِ اعْمَلُوا عَلَى مَكَانَتِكُمْ, do whatever in your position, position of disbelief, this position of sins and so on. إِنِّي عَامِلْ, indeed I am working. The Prophet ﷺ is working. Working to do what? To establish the belief. To be upon matters of iman, matters of belief. To be steadfast on the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it shows that the disbelievers are working and the believers are working. And the Prophet ﷺ is ordered to say that to them, that work, do work according to your position of disbelief and evil doing and so on. Inni amil, I am working. And then here's the warning, فَسَوْفَ تَعْلَمُونَ, you will definitely know, definitely you will have the knowledge. If you don't have it now, if you ridicule the truth now, well, فَسَوْفَ تَعْلَمُونَ, you will know, مَنْ تَكُونُ لَهُ عَاقِبَةُ الدَّارِ, who will have the outcome of the place, whether it's in this life or in the hereafter. And this is something that was true for the Prophet ﷺ, that the Prophet ﷺ was given عَقِبَةُ الدَّارِ, the Prophet ﷺ was given the outcome in this life, and the disbelievers, those who opposed the Prophet ﷺ, the Prophet ﷺ took over the city of Mecca. And the city of Mecca, after it used to be a place of idol worshipping, and for 365 idols were worshipped in the best place ever, the house of Allah that was built by Ibrahim alayhi salam, then the Prophet ﷺ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala aided him, and he opened the city of Mecca for the people of the faith, and purified it from all of these idol worshipping and so on. And in the hereafter, the place in the hereafter is the Jannah for the believers. So the warning and the threat for them, do whatever you want to do, I'm working in matters of al-Iman, فَسَوْفَ تَعْلَمُونَ, you will definitely know, مَنْ تَكُونُ لَهُ عَاقِبَةُ الدَّرْ, the عَاقِبَةُ, the outcome. The Qur'an talks about this in many places in the Qur'an, that the outcome is for the believers. that do not be trapped in the immediate moment that you're living in. People, you might see things are not according to what you like. You might see that the believers are being humiliated, outnumbered, whatever things that a person might see. But when a person recites verses like this, don't worry, the outcome is definitely a beautiful one. Your job is to fulfill the purpose of your life, and that is to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Your job on the face of earth is not to establish the outcome as is meant by the verses in the Quran and the hereafter. Your goal is to be obedient to Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you victory. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make you established. And more importantly, in the hereafter. إِنَّهُ لَا يُفْلِحُ الظَّالِمُونَ The ظَالِمُونَ, they would never succeed. The wrongdoers, those who commit injustices, they would never be in that state of al-falah or the state of success. And the falah or the success is the everlasting one. It's the one that is not terminated. It's not the one that is temporary. Otherwise, it's not really called falah or success. If someone is given a promise of being a successful person, but for a few years, and then he will be in the lowest level ever. Someone would say to him, whatever business you're in, you'll be very successful. And then after a few years, you will be in the worst level on the face of earth. Nobody would think at that moment that he would attain any success. Why? Because he would go to the worst level whatsoever. So the same thing when it comes to matters of the hereafter. The zalimun, the wrongdoers, the evildoers, they would never succeed. It's only something temporary. They think that this is success. Success by being disobedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What do people define success? When they have money, when they have power, when they're able to do things when they desire it. And then after that, what happens? If they ruin themselves, if they're upon wrongdoing, it's only temporary and they would never attain success in the absolute sense of it. So who are the ones that would attain al-falah or success? Are the believers. And that's what we hear every time the adhan is being called. Hayya ala al-falah. Come to the success, which is the salah, the masajid, the houses of Allah, the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then after that, in the next two verses, talks about some of the evil practices of the idol worshippers at the time of the Prophet ﷺ. And this is, by the way, something that keeps on happening. As we said, as a rule, if people are associating partners with Allah, they would invent all kinds of evil and foolish practices, because the foundation is evil and foolish. When people associate partners with Allah, or they worship images or other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One of these evil practices is mentioned in the next verse, which is verse number 136. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَجَعَلُوا لِلَّهِ مِمَّا ذَرَأَ مِنَ الْحَرْثِ وَالْأَنْعَامِ نَصِيبًا فَقَالُوا هَذَا لِلَّهِ بِزَعْمِهِمْ وَهَذَا لِشُرَكَائِنَا فَمَا كَانَ لِشُرَكَائِهِمْ فَلَا يَصِلُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَمَا كَانَ لِلَّهِ فَهُوَ يَصِلُ إِلَى شُرَكَائِهِمْ سَاءَ مَا يَحْكُمُونَ Which roughly means, and the polytheists assigned to Allah from that which He created of crops and livestock a share and say, this is for Allah, by their claim. And this is for our partners associated with Him. But what is for their partners does not reach Allah, while what is for Allah, this reaches their partners. Evil is that which they rule. And this is an evil practice that they used to have. وَجَعَلُوا لِلَّهِ مِمَّا ذَرَأَ مِنَ الْحَرْثِ وَالْأَنْعَامِ They made to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They assigned to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala مِنَ الْحَرْثِ وَالْأَنْعَامِ From al-harth. Al-harth is the crops in general, anything that is cultivated. وَالْأَنْعَامِ The livestock, whether it's goat, sheep, or camels, or cows. So they made from the livestock and the crops نصيباً. نصيباً means a share. They made a share. That means they would have a portion of it for the sake of Allah, meaning that they would feed the poor from it, they would do good deeds with it, and so on. And another portion, they would keep it for their idols that they worship besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَقَالُوا So they would say, this is how they invented their own religion. فَقَالُوا هَذَا لِلَّهِ بِزَعْمِهِمْ This is what for Allah, بِزَعْمِهِمْ By their claim. Because where did they come up with this? No revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not order them to do so. And by the way, and this is something that might be a shock to somebody, that many things that are on the face of earth is only claims. People claim to do things. where they have whatever they claim from, Allah knows best. We'll continue with this point specifically and the rest inshallah ta'ala after the break. So stay with us inshallah. Alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. Welcome back, and with verses number 133 to 137, and we are in verse number 136. Specific point here about the polytheists, those who associate partners with Allah, when they made a portion of the crops that they grow, or the livestock, they would make a portion of it for the good deeds, for Allah subhanahu, for the sake of Allah, for the poor, and so on and so forth, and a portion for the idols that they worship besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the verse says, هذا, they said, قالوا, فقالوا هذا لله بزعمهم. They said this is to Allah by their claim. They claim this way. And we stop there, and it's a very important point, because either we follow the revelation from Allah, and the revelation is the Quran and the authentic Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, or we're inventing, we're claiming things that has no proofs to it whatsoever. Religion is not what people like, is not what people would get together and decide as a religion, or something that would make them feel good, or it makes sense. And that's why when people need to ask themselves, the way that they worship, whether they worship even Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, and they do not associate partners with Allah, or they associate partners with Allah and they worship other than Allah, where did they come up with these acts of worship? How are they worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Who is the one that taught them how to worship Allah? How do they pray? For example, when people, they go to churches or whatever, did Isa alayhi salam, Jesus the son of Mary, prayed the same way the Christians, they pray today? Very simple question. Can people really trace back and to see for sure that this was the case? And if the answer is no, who invented this? It's all invention. People invented, people claimed. Moreover, matters of belief, many denominations, many sects, many ways, even among those who claim to be Muslims, even among Muslims, those who innovate in the matters of the deen, they claim something that is not based on the revelation from Allah. If there is differences of opinions among the people of knowledge based on the revelation from Allah, this is a valid thing. But when people invent religion, whether it's a matter of belief, distorting the matters of belief, or saying to the people that we believe this, and someone will come up with another belief, based on what? Based on their own thinking and their own reason and intellect. And this is how the people of Jahiliyyah, times of ignorance, at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, a person even at their time might see that this is something, what's wrong with that? They had their crops, and they actually, when you look at it deeply, crops that they grow, and they would take a portion of it, and they would say this is for Allah, meaning to give the poor and the needy and so on. And a portion of it, they give it to their idols that they are worshipping besides Allah. The same thing for their livestock. Some of the animals would be only for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and other animals for to be sacrificed for their idols, their images that they built. This is, by the way, a practice that many people, they do today. And this is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is showing, that this is their claim. They invented this. It's a very important concept as Muslims that we need to be upon firmly. And that is, the religion has nothing to do with invention. If you want to be religious, don't invent. Follow the revelation from Allah. Follow the wahi, the revelation from Allah, the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Of course, the people of knowledge, those who explain to us the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Sufyan al-Thawri rahimahullah, one of the early generations of Islam, he said, وَجَدْتُ الْأَمْرَ لِلْتِبَعِ. I found this matter, this religion is one word, al-ittiba', to follow, not to invent. So the disbelievers, they invented. And they would say, وَهَذَا لِشُرَكَائِنَا, and this is for their partners that they associate with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَمَا كَانَ لِشُرَكَائِهِمْ. Even worse, they would say that whatever is for their idols that they worship besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that doesn't reach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The verse has two meanings. One meaning is, they, part of their claim is that whatever they keep for their idols, it would not reach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It would not reach those who are to be given for the sake of Allah. وَمَا كَانَ لِلَّهِ فَهُوَ يَصِلُ إِلَى شُرَكَائِهِمْ. And what's for Allah, what's the portion that is for Allah, for the sake of Allah, this can reach their idols or their idols can benefit from it. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, سَاءَ مَا يَحْكُمُونَ. How evil it is what they rule. This is the ruling that they invented. How evil it is, even in the ruling, they made injustices and wrongdoing in the rulings. So the initiation of it, the foundation of it is evil, and it's not just. And of course, what even comes after that is evil and is not just. Another meaning to the verses, some of the ulama, they said, which is also true, that فَمَا كَانَ لِشُرَكَائِهِمْ فَلَا يَصِلْ إِلَى اللَّهِ. What's for their partners or that they worship besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whatever is given for them, it's not going to reach Allah. Of course it's not going to reach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most rich. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not accept the ibadah or the acts of worship or the good deeds unless it's purely for the sake of Allah. If it's mixed for the sake of Allah and for the sake of other than Allah, it's rejected, it's not accepted. So whatever is for Allah, the portion that they were sincerely doing it for the sake of Allah, it's rejected, it's not accepted, it's not going to reach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمَا كَانَ لِلَّهِ فَهُوَ يَصِلُ إِلَى شُرَكَائِهِمْ. Which is basically what's for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, so their partners that they worship besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, these are all creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the statement that says clearly, سَاءَ مَا يَحْكُمُونَ, how evil it is what they rule. So this is always the case for those who rule away from the revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The last verse, 137, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then after that mentioned another evil practice from the people of polytheism, the disbelievers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the verse 137, وَكَذَلِكَ زَيَّنَ لِكَثِيرٍ مِّنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ قَتْلَ أَوْلَادِهِمْ شُرَكَاؤُهُمْ لِيُرْدُوهُمْ وَلِيَلْبِسُوا عَلَيْهِمْ دِينَهُمْ وَلَوْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ مَا فَعْلُوهُ فَذَرْهُمْ وَمَا يَفْتَرُونَ. Which means, and likewise, to many of the polytheists, their partners have made to seem pleasing the killing of their children in order to bring about their destruction and to cover them with confusion in their religion. And if Allah had willed, they would not have done so. So leave them and that which they invent. وَكَذَلِكَ زَيَّنَ لِكَثِيرٍ مِّنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ. Likewise, as it's mentioned in the previous verse, this is also likewise many of the mushrikeen, many of those who associate partners with Allah, many of those who are polytheists, those who worship Allah and worship other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, many of them has been adorned for them, what? An evil action. قَتْلَ أَوْلَادِهِمْ, to kill their children. Who's the one that made it fair seeming for them? Their partners. Their partners that they associated with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or their leaders and so on. They made fair seeming to them, pleasing for them to kill their own children. If anybody with a sound mind and sound innate, would that sound as a good thing or an evil thing? One of the worst and one of the worst evil things is to kill one's own children. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put in our hearts the love towards our children. This is not something for a person to build over time or to acquire after living with our children. This is something by default is present in every single human being, even in animals. They have this love towards their children. So how can someone not just kill their children, but they find it as something that is pleasing or fair-seeming or something that would get them closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? This is how evil can overpower and overtake a person. This is how falsehood can lead a person astray, in which what's already in one's fitrah, one's innate and pure nature, can be totally corrupted as a subject like this, as they used to do this at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. By the way, the practices keep on going with the abortion and the like of this. So لِيُرْدُوهُمْ وَلِيَلْبِسُوا عَلَيْهِمْ دِينَهُمْ. The evildoers, their shayateen, their devils, those who are partners with them, and they whispered for them this evil so that they would destroy them, and وَلِيَلْبِسُوا عَلَيْهِمْ دِينَهُمْ, to mix the matter of the religion for them, to confuse them. And that's what the meaning of لِيَلْبِسُوا, to mix, to make the matter very confusing for them, matters of the religion. So this is one of the goals of shaitan, the devil, to make it the matter confusing for the people, matters of the religion, to destroy them by inventing things, by making things fair-seeming to them. And once they allow themselves to invent things in the religion, then the shaitan can take them from one step to the other till everything becomes an invention. And people would see how evil the subject is. وَلَوْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ مَا فَعَلُوا. If your Lord, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will, they would not be able to do so. And that's the power of Allah. This part of the verse is very powerful. It has implications to it. That if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will, they would have not done this evil. Some of the disbelievers, they have this question. They say, why the creator of the heavens and the earth allow people to kill, or to kill innocent people, or to kill children? Why, when these children, they have no fault, they have no sin whatsoever? This verse says, وَلَوْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ مَا فَعَلُوا. If Allah will, they would never be able to do so. They would never be able to do all of these evil things. So that means it's by the will of Allah. Everything is by the will of Allah. They're allowed to do this for a great wisdom. Allowed meaning it's not something that is pleasing to Allah. It's not something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered. This is an evil thing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warns against this. And He promised those who do these evil acts that they will be in hellfire forever. So what is the meaning of وَلَوْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ مَا فَعَلُوا? For the believers to have the comfort that if things already happened, if the evil is already happening, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will, it would never happen. So therefore, focus on your purpose of your life. Your job is to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to enjoy good and to forbid evil, and to call others to the truth with the certainty in your heart that if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will, they would not be able to do so. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the human beings the ability to choose whether to be good or whether to be evil. This is part of life. That even the evil doing on the face of earth, it's left for the human being, for them to be held accountable for their actions. And those who are treated with injustice, injustice would never prevail. The outcome definitely will be good for them. And that's why this is something that we should always remember. وَلَوْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ مَا فَعَلُوا. If they will, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will, they would never be able to do so. فَذَرْهُمْ وَمَا يَفْتَرُونَ. That means leave them and that which they invent. Leave them, it does not mean that you leave inviting them and giving them da'wah and calling them to the truth. But do not make their actions affect you. Do not make their actions make you in disparity or make you even leave your religion. Their actions is upon themselves. They are inventing. They're inventing this evil, whether it's the ruling to kill their children or what's mentioned before with the crops and the livestock and so on. This is all invention. They invented, they lied. And it's all lies because when people invented matters of the religion, they claim that this is what's pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And how would they know that it's pleasing to Allah? And this is such an amazing thing that when people claim to be upon a religion and they claim that they are pleasing Allah and they're doing things to please Allah, to seek the pleasure of Allah. These idol worship used to feed the poor and they were very generous. And people would think that this is that it's pleasing Allah. It's only pleasing to Allah if it's purely for the sake of Allah. If it's according to the from Allah, the Quran and the Sunnah. But if it's a way that is invented from the people and it's opposing, therefore it's not pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So leave them to invent because definitely they would see the outcome of their actions. As we see, and we cover this very briefly, but the verses that are very powerful and the benefits that we learn from these verses are so many benefits. And that's why we need to reflect upon them. We have to reflect upon the fact that the Lord, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Rabb, and with the meaning of Ar-Rabb, then we have to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accordingly. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in no need of His creation. And at the same time, He's the most merciful. So turn to the most merciful subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's not the like the human beings. Nothing is the like of Allah. Nothing is the like of Him whatsoever. And therefore, He ought to be the only one to be worshipped. That's why when we link the first part of the verse that we talked about today in the end, the only one worthy of worship is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because He is al-Ghafur Rahma, the most rich one that is the most merciful. There is no need to invent in matters of the religion, and falsehood leads to falsehood. If people would follow that to invent in matters of the religion, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's promise to them is the Jannah, is the paradise, is the goodness, as a result of them being steadfast on the deen of Allah and exposing the evil practices of the polytheists or those who associate partners with Allah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the proper understanding, to make us benefit from the book of Allah. Until next time, I leave you with the protection of Allah. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
أفلا يتدبرون القرآن
ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا
أفلا يتدبرون القرآن ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا
يتدبرون القرآن
ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا
أفلا يتدبرون القرآن ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا